Welcome back. So, happy October, first of all, and today we're going to talk about the October 1st material, starting section 11.6, talking about directional derivatives and a vector called the gradient vector. And for today, we're just going to focus on directional derivatives. The gradient vector is tomorrow. By the end of the day, here are the things that we should be able to do. First, we want to be able to give the definition of this quantity called the directional derivative, and that will be defined in terms of the dot product. We're going to want to be able to calculate the directional derivative of functions, and we're going to, even in the absence of a function's equation, we want to be able to say something intelligent about the sign of a directional derivative of a function just using its contour map. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Now, here's the idea. We had our partial derivative, f sub x, for example. And f sub x represented how fast the value of f was changing as we moved ever so slightly in the positive x direction. Likewise, we had f sub y, which represented the change in the value of f of xy as we moved ever so slightly in the positive y direction. But there are infinitely many directions in which you can move when you're in two-dimensional space. What about the negative x direction? What about the negative y direction? What if you wanted to move northwest? What if you wanted to move in some other direction? What if you wanted to move in whatever direction you wanted, and you wanted to know what effect that had on the output of the function? That's where directional derivatives come into play. The directional derivative in the direction of a unit vector called u is the rate of change of f of xy as you move the input xy slightly in the direction of the given vector u. Okay, so someone says, I want to move in the xy plane just a little bit in the direction of this vector u, which I'm going to specify. Tell me how the output of the function changes as a result. So if you want to actually calculate this quantity, you can do so using a dot product. You can say, well, okay, I have the rate of change in the x direction. I also have the rate of change in the y direction. Meanwhile, the vector u has an x component and a y component. What I'm going to do is I'm going to combine these two vectors by taking their dot product. Multiply the rate of change in the x direction with the component of u in the x direction. Multiply the rate of change in the y direction with the component of u in the y direction. And then take those two products and add them together to get the total overall rate of change in the direction of the unit vector u. Now, perhaps it is not clear. I just want to make sure that you know that I'm using u1, u2, that vector to represent the vector u in component form. Okay, just take the dot product. Take the dot product of the two partials with the two components of your given vector u. All right, let's try an exercise. Let's find the directional derivative of the function f of xy equals x squared y plus 3x to the fourth power. In what direction? U equals the vector 3 comma negative 1. And where are we going to start our movement? We'll start from the point 1, 2, and then we'll move in the direction of u. Now, I want you to pause the video for a moment and think, what is kind of strange? What is a little bit weird about this question based on what we have said earlier as we were setting up these formulas and definitions? And of course, the issue is u itself. Here in blue, or if you're not color inverted, here in red, we've specified that the vector that's given has to be a unit vector. But the vector that's been given to us is not a unit vector at all. It looks like it has length square root 10. So what we're going to do first, get an actual unit vector, in the same direction as the given vector 3, -1. So we're going to get a unit vector in the same direction. So someone has still communicated their direction to me, go in this direction, the same one as 3, -1, but I need to transform this into a unit vector in order to use the formula. So let's find the length of this vector by taking the square root of the x component and the y component, result root 10. And then let's go ahead and let's divide each of these components by root 10. 3 root 10, negative 1 root 10. Now this is an actual, honest to goodness, unit vector. Okay. So we have finished figuring out what the real true vector u is for this problem. And the next thing that we're going to have to do is figure out what is going on with f sub x and f sub y. So let's calculate the partial derivatives here. All right, I'm going to zoom out a little bit so we can still see the formula, but we have room to write. Let's calculate f sub x. Treating y is a constant, applying power rule to x squared y, we have 2x times y. Take the derivative of 3x to the fourth power, we get 12x cubed. Now, at the specified point, 1, 2, if I plug that in, 2 times 1 times 2 plus 12 times 1 cubed, result 4 plus 12 looks like 16. Now let's do the same process with the y variable, f sub y. Let's make this another color just for clarity. F sub y, treating y as the variable and x as the constant, x squared times y, power rule, the constant multiple x squared will survive, plus 3x to the fourth power. You take the derivative of that, it's a constant, so it vanishes. And then if we plug in the given point, 1, 2, we have x squared 1 squared, result 1. All right, all that remains for us to do is to calculate the dot product of our x derivative, y derivative, dotted with our x direction and our y direction. And we have 16 times 3, that's 42, I think. No, that's 48. I feel like you get worse at arithmetic the further you go in math. 1 times negative 1. So in total, the rate of change in the specified direction is 47 over square root 10. That would be my final answer for this directional derivative. Okay, so let's consider then how we might describe a directional derivative even if we didn't have access fully to the equation, maybe just to the contour map. So we have the function xy, familiar friend from before, whose contour map is given below. And let's determine the sign of the directional derivative of f, and they've specified the point negative 1, 1. So perhaps I'll just go right ahead and find the point negative 1, 1, which is living directly on the level curve z equals 0. Okay, now the first directional derivative they want me to consider, the unit vector that they've given me, is 1 over root 2, 1 over root 2. So that has an equal positive x and y coordinate. So that is poking out in the direction written here. Positive x, positive y, equal in size, pokes out in that direction. Now, if we move from our given point a little bit in that direction, we're moving away from the level curve z equals 0 toward the level curve z equals 1. So the outputs are going up, outputs go up, so the directional derivative must be positive because we saw an increase in our output values. Let's erase that and let's do the second one where we're at the same location but the direction has changed. Now they want to know what is happening if we move in the direction negative 1 over root 2, 1 over root 2. So that's going to have a positive x and a negative y of precisely the same slope, size rather. Now look at that movement. Not only is it tangent to this level curve z equals 0, that vector lies completely on this level curve z equals 0. So tangent to level curve in an extreme way. And as a result, the function's value is constant and the derivative is 0. And finally, they say, well, what about if you go southwest? What if you go in the direction negative x and negative y? If we move even slightly in that direction, we move off the level curve z equals 0 toward the level curve z equals negative 1. So outputs are going down, and as a result, the directional derivative will be negative in that direction at that particular point. So this is how we can analyze the sign of a directional derivative from something like a contour map. Move a little bit in the specified direction and check and see, do your z values remain constant? Do your z values go up or do they go down? If it increases, the derivative has positive sign. If it stays the same, the derivative is 0. And if the function values decrease, the derivative is negative, just as it was when we were doing partial derivatives using contour maps.